Welcome back, everybody. We're going to start a new chapter of our course today. We're going to talk about the independent samples t-test. The independent samples t-test is now the second type of t-test that we'll be learning. We're going to put it through the same four-step hypothesis testing procedure that we learned before. So we're learning that that four-step procedure is really very flexible, and it's going to be very helpful to us throughout this semester. With the independent samples t-test, we check for differences between two independent groups. So essentially, we'd be in a situation where we're comparing something like a group of men to a group of women on some measure. Along the way, we'll talk about a variety of topics, but for this particular video, I want to focus on the difference between a between subjects research design and a within subjects research design so that you understand the rationale and the logic of the independent samples t-test. It's important for us to understand the difference between those two types of research designs, the way we design our research study, because the statistical analyses that we do are dictated by the research design. And so far, to this point, we've only analyzed data that's been collected from one sample. So you might recall we learned a one-sample z-test and also a one-sample t-test. And because both of those research designs involved collecting data from one sample, we had to use an analysis technique that specifically focused on one sample. But in the real world, most studies compare two or more different samples of data. And if we're comparing two samples of data, that's because we really want to compare the populations that they represent. So in a two-sample design, we collect data from two different subsets of a population, in other words, two different samples, so that we can draw inferences about the populations those samples represent. It's important to understand that there are two basic ways we can design a research study so that we're collecting data from two or more samples. One way involves a between subjects research design, and that's what this chapter will focus on. Sometimes those are called independent samples research designs or independent measures research designs. Those three terms really do focus on the exact same thing. So we can use those three terms interchangeably. I know that only adds to some confusion for you, and I'm sorry about that, but I don't make the rules. People don't consult me when they're naming different research designs. We will typically refer to a two-group research design, the one we're about to talk about right now, as an independent samples research design. But a lot of people call it between subjects, so just make sure that you're familiar with that term. The reason why I like the term independent samples is because it's easier to see in your head what that means. We will be comparing two completely independent samples of people or things. That makes sense. That's intuitive. So in that situation, we might be comparing a sample of men to a sample of women. They're clearly independent, separate groups of people. That's what makes that the between subjects or independent samples research design. In other words, the hallmark of that type of research design is that we're comparing two or more separate, completely independent groups. And then with the independent samples t-test, we'll analyze differences between those group means. So this is exactly the type of situation that we're going to be focusing on in this chapter. But it's important to understand there's another way that we can collect data and end up with two groups of data. And we're going to be learning about that soon and analyzing that type of data soon. So let's just make sure we understand that situation as well. In that situation, we call that research design a within subjects research design or a related samples research design, sometimes also referred to as a related measures research design. Those three terms really are focusing on exactly the same thing. Those three terms can be used interchangeably. I like to focus on the term related samples because, again, you're going to see that makes sense. It's intuitive. A related samples research design is when we collect data from the same people two or more times. So, for example, I might collect data from you at the very beginning of the semester to see how much you know about statistics. And then I might collect data from you again, same group of people, again, at the end of the semester to see how much your class has learned. So I'll have a group of data at week one and then a group of data from week 16. And I can compute an average from week one and an average from week 16 and compare those two. But do you see how that data comes from two samples that are related? They're related because they consist of the exact same people. In that situation, you'll see when we talk about it in a few weeks, we will analyze different scores. So I'll look at how well you did at time one, And then I'll look at how well you did at time two, and I'll see how much you changed. How much did you differ from time one to time two? And we'll analyze that type of difference. That's what the within subjects or related samples research design is all about. The reason I'm bringing this up now is because as we learn more and more statistical tests, as we encounter more and more research designs, we need to be able to pick them apart, identify them, and then determine what's the most appropriate statistical test. So now is the time to start thinking about that. But let me be very clear. In this chapter, we are going to focus on the independent samples research design, the between subjects research design, so that we can learn how to do an independent samples t-test. So let's talk about that in a little bit more detail. Here's a good example of a basic setup for an independent samples research study. Imagine that I want to compare two populations of students. One population of students taught statistics face-to-face, in person. I want to compare them with another population of students. These students will be taught statistics online, remotely. If I were to give those two populations the exact same stat test, at this point, I don't know what those population means would be. So I don't know if one technique is more effective than the other. And I also know that these populations are very large. I can't measure the entire populations. I can't recruit the entire population of students taking statistics, either face-to-face or online, and then ask them to be involved in this research study. That type of thing just simply isn't going to happen. But what we can do, what is doable, is measuring a subset of those populations. In other words, I can measure a sample of the people who have been taught statistics online, and I can compare that sample to another sample of people who have been taught face-to-face. And of course, there's going to be some variability within each one of these samples, but I can boil down that data to a group mean for each sample, and then I can compare these two group means. The reason I want to compare these two sample means is because I want these two sample means to inform me about the two populations that they represent, specifically because I want to see if these two populations differ. So when we embark on an independent samples research study, we want to compare two different populations. So we're essentially asking the question, is there a difference between population A and population B? You can probably already guess that the null hypothesis will be that there is no difference between those two populations. In other words, if I were to compare them, if I were to look for differences between those two populations, the difference would be zero. And if there really were no differences between those populations, most of the differences that I would see between the two sample means would be near zero. But this story is going to sound familiar. Remember, sampling error exists. This is the beautiful thing about our class. We keep putting ourselves in different research situations. In this situation, we're comparing two different groups. In the situations we were in previously, we were just looking at one group of data that we collected. But we're always putting ourselves in the same situations overall, a situation where we're looking for differences and we're trying to determine what those differences mean, because we're going to find some type of difference. Because remember, even if there are no differences between the populations, we will find differences between the samples just due to sampling error. In other words, you can pretty much bank on the fact that we are going to find differences between these two sample means. But the question will then remain, why did we find those differences? Do we have differences between those two sample means because differences actually exist between the two populations? Or are the differences that we see between these two sample means best explained by sampling error? So we will run through the four-step hypothesis testing procedure to see if we can reasonably rule out sampling error as a viable explanation for the differences we see. That, my friends, is the basic rationale for the independent samples t-test. I mentioned that this independent samples t-test is the second type of t-test that we've learned. Of course, we know a little bit about the one sample t-test, and now we're going to be learning about this new independent samples t-test. Let's just compare and contrast those. You'll see in some ways, as we move through the four steps of the hypothesis testing procedure, these two tests are actually remarkably similar. So let's do a quick review. The one sample t-test uses literally one sample, that's what X bar is, that's a sample mean, to draw inferences about a population mean. So we're using one sample mean to learn about some unknown population mean. The independent samples t-test is similar, but it extends that, because now we're using two different sample means from two completely independent groups to draw inferences about the difference between two completely independent populations. Regardless of those specific differences between the one sample t-test and the independent samples t-test, both t-tests are essentially set up the same way, because in the numerator of the t-equation, we're looking at differences that we're actually observing between our sample data and some unknown population mean. And then we're comparing those differences to the differences we would expect to find just by chance, and we know that's measured by the standard error. This chart breaks it down reasonably well. The one sample test literally collects data just from one sample. The independent samples t-test collects data from two completely separate samples. But in both cases, the test statistic that we compute is t. So the critical region that we use is based on the t-distribution, and we will use the exact same t-table for both different tests. I mentioned that the two t-statistics are set up the same way in terms of the numerator and the denominator. When we're looking at the one sample test, we're looking to see how much one sample mean differs from a population mean. For the independent samples t-test, we're looking at differences between two sample means and comparing those to the differences we would expect to find between two population means. In other words, the numerators of these equations are looking at differences we actually observe, and you might recall that we divide those differences by the differences we would expect to find just by chance, which is what the standard error is all about. Of course, there are going to be differences to the specific equations that we use, but the standard error of the mean will always represent, in some form, differences that we would expect to find just due to sampling error. In the case of the one sample t-test, we computed the estimated standard error of the mean. In the case of the independent samples t-test, we will compute the estimated standard error of the differences between the means. We'll talk in detail about how to compute that, and specifically how to compute pooled variance, in our next video. Let's address one more issue before we wrap up this video. We know that the one sample t-test and the independent samples t-test are both t-tests. So we're going to be conducting t-values in both situations, and that means we're going to be using the same t-table. The only thing that will differ when using that t-table is that the one sample t-test is based on just one sample, so when we compute degrees of freedom, we take the number of people in that sample and we subtract one. But for the independent samples t-test, remember we're collecting data from two completely independent samples. Both of those samples have n minus 1 degrees of freedom. So in this situation, we can take the number of people in the first group, let's say we're talking about men, and then subtract 1, and then take the number of people in the second group, let's say we're talking about women, and subtract 1 from that group, and then add those two together. That's the same thing as taking the number of men, the number of women, and then subtracting 2. Those two methods of computing degrees of freedom are equivalent, and that's how we will compute degrees of freedom for the independent samples t-test. Well, I think that's enough for now. In the next video, we'll start talking about what we need to do to compute the standard error for the independent samples t-test. And what we really need to do first in that situation is compute what we call pooled variance. That'll be the topic for the next video. I'll see you then. In the meantime, be safe.